Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking on the critical state-of-the-art technologies that are used for the Indian AEWNC program. If we look at the world scenario, we have mainly some of the state-of-the-art systems developed by Saab and Embraer, and also systems that are mounted on G550 and Boeing platforms, and our own IL-76 from Israel. Our AEWNC system is based on the Embraer platform, and looking at the world scenario of various systems that are mounted on the AEWNC platform, we see that India has almost all the subsystems. Like the active aperture radar, IFF system, ESM, CSM, C-band data link, Ku-band, everything, unlike the other already developed systems on Embraer platform. One thing what it means is the challenges are there for both the aircraft manufacturer and also for the sensor manufacturer. Due to all these systems, we have to have constraints on weight, volume, power, and cooling. And the first in our system being the air-to-air refueling, the AESA radar with elevation scanning, the SATCOM system, and to meet the required power aperture products, the additional APUs and cooling packs for additional system for cooling the systems. And because of the in-flight refueling, we also have extra seats. Looking from the platform point of view, we have various modifications that has to be done, mainly for reinforcing for the AAAU, that is the AESA radar, which houses both the front end of primary radar and the secondary radar, the SATCOM radome, in-flight refueling, power, and also structural reinforcements for almost 59 antennas that are required from the sensor point of view. Sensors per se are basically the primary radar, secondary radar, mission system controllers, self-protection suites, data links, ESM and CSM systems, along with the operator workstation and the active antenna array unit. As an example, I will just take one hardware system and one software system to bring out the criticality of the technologies that are involved. If we look at it, we see that the antenna is almost mounted with lot of the aircraft is mounted with almost lot of antennas, which is a challenge by itself, both from the EM point of view and from the field of viewpoint. Coming to AAAU as an example, this requirement has to be decided jointly, because from the sensor point of view, the requirements are from beam widths of the antenna and the gain of the antenna, which indirectly defines the size, and also from the EM aspects for distortion of pattern, which defines the height at which the antenna has to be mounted. But this is one of the contradictory requirements, because from the aircraft point of view, the larger the antenna, the more the drag and handling qualities, and higher height implies again these parameters. So we have to compromise either on the field of view or from the EM point, or to get a better power aperture product, we have to, for a smaller size of antenna, we have to have the enhanced power. So these are some of the trade-offs we have to have at the beginning of the system. And one of the exercises what we did was to test and simulate and see what is the effect of the body on the aircraft due to the aircraft. And based on this, we have arrived at the size of the antenna in terms of height, width, and length of the antenna, and also the height of mounting from the platform to the top of the antenna. Looking at the system per se, the concept, the AAAU basically houses both the front end of radar and IFF, and it has to work individually with either of the systems, with mission system controller controlling the total sensors, and the operator workstation is used for command and control of these sensors. AAAU per se has core technologies in terms of materials and manufacturing, which had to be decided from point of strength, maintainability, impacts, and manufacturing tolerances that are available. From the electrical point of view, we had to look for the different kind of power supplies meeting the EMIMC requirements. From the environmental, it has to work in an airborne environment where it is exposed to rain, lightning, erosion, electrostatic charges, temperature, and icing. From the mechanical point of view, again, the applied, it has to withstand the applied loads and strengths, and also the weight is one of the constraints, and also the shock and vibration effects. From the aerodynamics, we have to see that the external airflow and internal flow for cooling of electronics are maintained. And from the electronics and software, we have the antenna design, the radome, the MIC technologies, and embedded technologies. If you look from the AAAU, this is a challenging system to work because of the amalgamation of all these technologies, which has to work together to meet the essential requirements. Generally, many of the antennas, such antennas, have been designed with a standalone radome, and the antenna panels are inside, around which the LRUs are mounted. Due to the space constraints, which was brought out from the elevation scanning point of view, we had to go for a cladded radome technology to see that the width is not increased, thus not increasing the drag and handling qualities of the aircraft. So the radome properties per se, we had to check for its peel strength and also its electromagnetic properties, which is around 0.5 dB in S-band and around 0.2 dB for one-way in L-band, which covers both the primary radar and the secondary radar. Though it has its advantage because it gives a low loss of power due to clad technology and better performance in scanned conditions, we have challenges because the antenna itself has to satisfy all the structural properties and to bear the aerodynamic loads on it, and to also meet the electromagnetic requirements and the maintainability issues that can come due to this impinging of the aerodynamic loads on it. So with this as the background, we went with the structural design. With 2008, when we contracted to Embraer, we started this design, where we got the structural modeling was done from CAPS, and the loads were dictated from Embraer, what would be coming onto the system. And based on this, the modeling was done, and various analysis has been carried out for limit load, ultimate loads, buckling, etc. And we had to reiterate some of the things where we had to look at the model back and redesign some of the aspects of the model to ensure that the necessary margins of safety within the allowables are met. Apart from this, from the aerodynamic point of view, we also have carried out the wind tunnel study at IAC facility. Having a 1:10 model, this basically helped us to benchmark our analysis against the experiments so that the further analysis in case anything is required could be handled. This basically helped us to design what should be the aperture opening for intake of the air for cooling of the electronic system. And coming from the cooling aspects of the electronic system, we have two major modules that are heat dissipating in nature, mainly the transmit receive multi-module and also the multi-output power supplies. We have designed the transmit receive modules in such a way that it is having a distributed power heat dissipating units, as we see in the figure here. And because of this distribution, we have also achieved the elevation scanning, thereby giving a total active array for the whole AWNC system. If we see from the heat dissipating and considering the amount of thermal exposure it can get into and taking the junction temperatures into consideration, we see that maximum of around 15 CFM of air is required for cooling of the TR modules. And also from the point of multi-output power supply, we see that around 20 meters of air is required for cooling of the multi-output power supply. This is at the extreme temperature conditions, which we will be subjected in India at around 55 degrees centigrade. Using this, we have done a combined internal and external flows for the total system. And one of the things we have done uniquely here is to vary the exit area to maintain the required pressure within the for the air cooling of the TR modules, with exit areas defined differently so that any module can be plugged in anywhere and the necessary cooling can be carried out with this design that has been carried out. We see from this design that we are meeting the required cooling temperatures of around 15 CFM, we see that most of the TRMMs are getting cooled to that one, and also the multi-output power supply that can meet the requirements even at 55 degree centigrade. Apart from this, we have also conducted the model analysis tests and established the resonant frequencies, vibration bending movements, and vertical bending movements. The tests were carried out at NAL Bangalore, and also the structural strength testing for various limit load and ultimate load cases were also carried out, which was cleared from Embraer for all its requirements. Because we have the air intake aspect, and it is a flying unit, we have a scare of bird hits that can happen onto the system, and we have carried out the bird hit test and also the lightning test at lightning facility at CAPS. Coming to the antenna per se, what I mentioned earlier, we have to do a test on structural withstanding of the antenna and also in the clad condition whether it meets the required mill specifications. We see that it is an integrated PR-IFFR array antenna having both the slots for the primary radar and the secondary radar. And the connectors here shows that it is fully active antenna what we have used here. And it is the cladded antenna which was subjected to various tests like the vibration and acceleration, the high temperature and low temperature, humidity and salt fog tests, which has yielded that it is meeting the required specifications. Once this job was completed, we have assembled the antenna together, and this was cleared by FAR as per the FAR requirements from the ANAC inspectors from Brazil. And with this, we further carried out the tests, GVT tests on the AAAU at Embraer facilities, which correlated perfectly with the analysis made by CAPS, and it was mounted on the aircraft, and we had the maiden flight on 6th of December. What I would like to emphasize here is this is a remarkable feat, because from 2008 to 2011, we could meet the airborne requirement, though it was attempted for the first time. Apart from the structural aspects, we have the functional aspects that was going parallelly in terms of development of TR modules, which is air-cooled TR modules, and all the other units which are also air-cooled, like the RF manifolds in terms of antenna beamforming unit, bytecal unit, and the power dividers, the beam control unit for the secondary systems and the power supplies, and also the signal and power motherboards which can take the units on plug-and-play basis, thus giving better maintainability aspects and easy removal and fitment back. We see the assembly here, and the number of cables, etc., are humongous, and this was a difficult feat of work that has been completed by the team. To handle all the electronics that are put into the AAAU, there is certainly a need for a proper hardware and a software to handle the total functionality. And the functionality of both IFF and the primary radar has to be handled simultaneously, which is done using the controller card which has been developed. This ensures the tandem working of all the TR modules when it switches between the transmit and receive, and also for switching between the right and left of the array. Tandem working of the beam controller units for IFF system, switching for ECCM requirements, health reporting, as this is sitting on the top of the aircraft, the constant health reporting is handled by this card, and the necessary software associated with it. It also caters for handling of online calibration and maintenance mode of operations. So this card development also was done simultaneously, so that today we have a system that is put together, and this was evaluated at the planar near field measurement facility at CAPS, and various pattern measurements were carried out for both transmit and receive in both azimuth and elevation and under various scanned condition to see that the array performs as per the requirements of the AWNC aircraft. And we also see the performance of the array at intercardinal planes, which is not showing up any spurious lobes at any other intercardinal planes. We have also conducted the cross-polar and back-lobe measurements, and the array has been integrated and is available from the system test and integration rig, working for almost around 2 years now, undergoing the various tests for evaluation of the radar, and it is now ready to be tested on board the aircraft. Another system which I was talking was a mission system controller, which is highly software intensive, which is built on the COTS hardware. This basically handles the command and controls of sensors on board and also does the air-to-ground communication management. It does, because of the AWNC kind of a platform, it is a perfect candidate for carrying out the sensor data fusion, which is carried out in this system, where we have both kinematic fusion and information fusion, along with threat assessment, intercept control, and guidance and recovery. As we see, what is marked in red is a difficult task to do because it requires tacit knowledge that has to be given from the users. I mean, just to lighten the moment, I just bring out, if you have a requirement saying that my animal should have four legs, should carry both passenger and cargo, black in color, should be herbivorous, and should have a protrusion on the face area. We say we have offered everything, and the customer requirement was something this, but what is offered is something like this. There is a lot of gap that can come when we are doing. So understanding the perceptions and having the statistical data collected is essential to carry out this information fusion and also translating of that tacit knowledge, which requires larger timelines for requirement gathering. And also conversion of the tacit information to algorithms. It is difficult because first of all we have to understand the information, and proper implementation of the algorithm becomes essential. And either the understanding is wrong or the implementation of is wrong, both yields unnecessary results, which we have to again test it. And testing of the such systems for various realistic cases is itself a task by itself, and this has to be done with the joint development of scenarios between the users and the developers. And recording the outcomes and tweaking the algorithms to suit the requirements is essential, and once this is done, we have to go through the regression testing. So we decided that we will go with a number of builds, which is evolutionary model, and planning. We go with the planning, where we go with a requirement capture followed by a preliminary design. And we also decided that we will go through various MATLAB simulations, and that shall be evaluated by the users. And any mistake in the requirement capture is short-circuited at this phase, and we reacquire the requirements again before we embark on the detailed design. This helps us in evaluating the alternatives and identify the risks at this stage itself before we embark on the detailed design. Once the detailed design is done, we implement in the RTOS, followed by unit testing and integrated testing, which is a requirement as per DO 178B, and final validation, verification and validation is carried out both by the IVNV team and also from the users. And various artifacts that are required are produced at each stage. Apart from these artifacts, we also decided that we will have additional documents like the tactical design guideline document, which is a sign-off between us and the user, and user evaluation and test reports at both the preliminary stage and also at the final stage. So this has helped us to shorten the life cycle of the software and seeing to that the necessary requirements are met. Coming to the basic one of the things, we have gone ahead with the sensor data integration with estimation theory and automatic identification and classification using the weighted voting logic, because various sensors has to be are heterogeneous in nature, and this calls for alignment of both data in time and space, and also to estimate the biases of each of the sensor. Then the track-to-track fusion association and leading to fusion is done. Based on this information, we go with the evidence processing, which is again the tacit knowledge that has been captured from the user. We have the tactical data items, configuration data, and the system parameters, which helps us to identify and classify the tracks And once this is done, we go with the automatic threat assessment. Various techniques like estimation theory, weighted voting logic, fuzzy logics have been used to achieve this feat. And this is one of the snapshot of the system. And also, we have completed the performance and load testing of the system, and we are now on board to take on to the aircraft. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Suma. She brought out in the Indian AWNC program the critical challenges, particularly one example she took from hardware side, the other one is from the software.